It's very cinematic. So, Benny, come stay. Yeah. There you are. How are you?
Okay.
You're definitely not in the village. That's for sure.
Upstate.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
Seems to be the place to be at the moment.
Yes.
If only there were theaters running and... Right? If only there were cinemas and music and live things happening, maybe.
Yeah, my theater, I've sort of lost my theater too.
Is there a big question mark on its future, or are you saying it's just a fait accompli? I assume it's always you're at some degree hanging on by threads because of the nature of the business, but.
Yeah, but we own the building and we've been doing well for quite a while. Like, I've been there 37 years.
That's quite a while.
Yes. I mean, it seems highly unlikely to me that we're going to survive this from, even if the building, we can get the building to get through that. Are people going to go to plays anymore? Are people going to feel comfortable sitting in a dark space where somebody's coughing, you know?
Yeah, I of course say yes, because I want to be optimistic, and I feel like I've got a very enormous, stake in it myself, less than you, but I'm not the right person to ask, because, I'll say absolutely we're going to come back. People are going to be starved for live theater, you know? So there are things, steps can be taken, Tom. There could be steps in terms of, vaccination proof of that, you know, that there are certain steps we'll be doing for the foreseeable future to before we can go inside of a place where we might be sitting close to somebody else. But people are...
A lot of renovation would have to be done. A lot of air supply and,
on the slightly sunnier side, there's been a 4K restoration of your first directorial debut. What happened was, thanks to, in part, to oscilloscope, right?
Yeah.
How did that happen, by the way? Who approached whom, or who was involved in that conversation?
I'm sure I think they approached us. I mean, Scott McCauley is my producer.
And neighbor.
Yeah, I mean, he lives pretty close. I mean, when I'm in the city. And he just called up one day and said, they want to restore the movie. They want to go back and remaster everything. And I was like, geez, you know. And then we went and met them, and, you know, it's been cool. It's gone very, from my side of it, pretty quickly. I mean, retimed it in 2 days, 2.5 days.
You what?
And changed. Retimed it. I mean, change the timing is the color and the darkness.
I see.
Of each shot. So that went pretty quickly. Because a lot of things I'd always wanted to do and never did, because we were so, when I sold the movie or, you know, licensed it to Goldwyn, they wanted it to look a particular, they wanted it to look a particular way that would make it look better on TV, which seemed insane to me.
Did it ever play on television?
Yeah, well, I mean, it was on Netflix for a couple of years.
I know, but that's not what Samuel Goldwyn was talking about, right? They were talking about broadcast.
They were talking about change, you know, about in the transfer from the film to the video that they would then broadcast.
Yeah,
that video was very flat and very bright.
Did that ever happen? A broadcast?
Well, not even broadcast, just on a video screen. I mean,
okay, right. So we're watching with the VHS or whatever they were using at the time. Early to mid '90s.
And we missed the advent of DVDs.
Right.
What happened was came out, and then like the next year, DVD started, and it was,
Yeah.
So there meant a lot. It was really fun to change, you know, to make it look the way it really looked when we did it, which is much, much darker.
Okay, so there's two people in this whole film. It sort of plays out like a play. But I wanted to say from the bat, this is my third time seeing it, and it gets better each time.
No, thank you.
It's better. Especially, I mean, I haven't seen it since probably the last time we spoke.
Uh-huh.
So it's been a few, 2 or 3 years, but I watched it again. And it, like, you know, loved it. Loved it.
Oh, great. Really
loved it.
And you saw the remastered one. Or not.
Well, let's skip this part of the conversation because I think I just watched your copy. Okay. Your copy. So no, I'm looking forward to going to go bring myself to filmforum.net, whatever, and watching it virtually. Because that's where it's, we'll point people right from the bat. We'll say that you can go to whathappenedwas.oscilloscope.net. And you can get a list of all of the art cinemas that are going to play this virtually starting this Friday. But
yeah,
so choose your favorite one, or maybe arbitrarily choose one and support the film, support Tom, support art cinemas, because everybody needs support.
Also, can I add one little thing?
That's the whole idea. Add as much as you want, please.
A number of years ago, I wrote the sequel to What Happened Was, called What Happened Next. And
Ellipse.
and it looked like it was possibly going to get made, and then it didn't. So, but I like the script a lot, and it's, you know.
Is there an expiration date on it?
How could there be an expiration date on it?
I don't know. You and Karen.
We get too old to do it?
That's one example, but I don't know. you're very good looking. You look the same to me. A little gray around the edges, but you look the same to me. I just think you'd be great.
I mean, in the script I have, it's about 20 years later.
Oh, perfect.
But it could be, it'd be a little more, because the daughter is particularly important. We have a daughter. And she's still a teenager or a late, you know, she's 17 or 18. So if I got 20 years later than I am now, I wouldn't be able to do it. But for now, it'd probably work.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Karen, I saw a couple of years, I spoke to her I don't want to waste too much time on this, but I spoke to her some time ago for a Hal Hartley film. And that was also, you know, back in the news or whatever, but anyway. And then I was in LA, she asked me to stop by and visit. She of course, very believable too, for somebody who might have had a child within the last 20 years. Still, she looks fantastic, very healthy, you know, so that's good. So you could do this, the entire original cast.
There's a lot of people in it, but
in the new one,
there's probably 20 people.
Really? Okay. Yeah. Well, we'll talk about that one later because, you know.
I mean, I don't want to tell too much about it, but it's not real time. It's not, you know, it's sort of real, maybe, but a lot of the conceits that are in What Happened Was I've.
So if enough people watch What Happened Was, you might be able to finance or give a rationale for financing the sequel. If this is a big success and people rediscover or discover for the first time What Happened Was now with the new restored version, this would be a great way to help launch the sequel of it.
Yeah.
So I'm behind that 100%. You know, speaking of Karen Sillas, how did you find her? How did she end up playing opposite you in the film?
What happened is, I I was not an unknown actor at the time when I made this movie. I mean, I wasn't a big star, but people knew who I was.
Sure, of course.
So I went to all these women who were sort of that of that age that Karen is, and asked them to read it. And, you know, and these were well-known people that I'd been friendly with for a long time. And almost without an exception, they all thought it was sort of not very substantial. That was a comment I heard. They said, you're a nice guy and a good actor, but this is not the material of a play. There's nothing goes on. It's just, you just, there's two people sitting eating. I don't get
it. Have they been to the public theater? Because
well,
or so, any other experimental,
I couldn't find any, I couldn't find anybody of the people I knew to do it. So I had the slot in the theater booked, so I had to get going at a certain date. And it was a couple days away from that deadline. And I went to my agent and said, you know, do you have anybody sort of roughly my age do you think could do this and look at it? And, you know, and they said, well, everybody's booked, but Karen Sillas is around. And I remember I'd seen her in the Hal Hartley movies. And I said, oh, really? And they said, yeah, we'll arrange. We can have a meeting and maybe later in the week. And so I met her for breakfast, and I really didn't know her personally. What's happening there? My heater's going on for no reason. But I could tell immediately when we sat down to eat that it was going to work.
Yeah, you guys sorry to interrupt, but you guys,
the
chemistry, and it's not always great, you know, like, I'm not talking about necessarily romantic chemistry, I'm just talking acting chemistry, whatever. It's just, again, I had a much deeper appreciation on this viewing of what you guys created. But go ahead.
Yeah. No, and you know, my style of directing is that I don't tell people anything much ever. So we just ran it and forgot about the questions, and it was really great with her. Like, she was really up for, like, just run, let's run this 10 second section here 100 times. And it was great. So it was very easy. And it was very easy to do it. When I did it, I'd be, you know, directing and telling people what to do a little bit. And then they'd say, okay, your spot is right there. And I go, oh shit, I forgot I had to act in the scene. And I would get in, and it didn't feel like acting to me. I'd done it so much that I could just sort of let go and sort of went where it went.
So she did the stage version?
Oh yeah. That was the reason doing it.
All right. And then you guys shot it. It's not, I see a lot of these adaptations, and they're sometimes they feel very kind of staged, you know, like, oh, this is a play, and you just sort of shot it. But this feels like it works as a film in of itself. Like, right. You wouldn't feel like necessarily, oh, this, you might think, oh, this could be a play because of its, well, I don't know what you say, how it's described, but having one set and is this a two-hander? Is that what they call these? I don't know.
Yeah.
So anyway, it was also shot really great. So who was your DP? Who was your
senator? Joe DeSalvo. Joe DeSalvo. Do you know Joe?
No.
He's works a lot.
Okay.
Yeah, he's working with Springsteen now a little bit.
Oh, does he do those documentaries now?
I don't know what they're doing now, but I know that Joe was working with him a lot a couple years ago.
Uh-huh.
Because we rehearsed for 5 weeks for the play. The play ran for 5 weeks.
At your theater?
And then we found a location that I wanted to use, and we put a deposit down and you know, owned it for that period of time. And we would, whenever they weren't there, the people in that place, we'd go rehearse. So by the time we got to shoot, everybody in the crew knew every word in the script. And they knew exactly on what, you know, the dolly moves are just perfect. They're, you know, because everybody had been working on them so long. It's same with our acting.
Well, what do you mean in sense of from the play? There's no dollies, right? So you're talking about like rehearsals of the film after the play.
Yeah, as soon as we finished the play, we started rehearsing in the location. But as if we're, you know, and the way the play was done was there was no proscenium. It was in the round, basically.
Oh, okay.
Basically, well, I turned that theater, I turned my theater into a sort of an old apartment. And put lots of chairs and stuff, and audience could sit either on the set or in the set or away from the set. And so there's no place for playing toward. Everything was, you know, there's no fourth wall.
Right.
And the experience was, I really dug it, and I thought it worked pretty good. Because you don't have to go to another location now and reblock it and change things and.
Oh, I see. Right, that makes sense. I see what you mean. It's almost like a three-dimensional. That's not the way you describe it. Yeah, there's something more three-dimensional about that type of when it's in the round, right? There's no escape. it must be, I never thought about what that must be for the actor, the difference of going from where the audience is in front of you to being in the round, or at least three quarters, or however you're describing it, you know, where they're basically, there's nowhere to hide at all.
Right.
But this, the apartment in this film version, what happened was, it's quite striking. It's quite a presence. It's almost, as they say, sometimes it's like a character, but it's very specific. This couldn't be just any apartment, you know.
It was built. We got a little dance studio that had windows all around, and we built the apartment inside that box.
Okay, makes sense.
It's everything in there: the pillars, the ceiling, you know, all the sink and the kitchen, and that's all stuff we built in.
Yeah, and people like back in the days in the 70s and 80s when artists started, well, they had probably many had been there already, but when they started moving into these lofts and these big spaces that were impractical and there nobody understood why you'd want to live in them, but of course they became very coveted spaces and very expensive ultimately, but at the back in the day, the idea of moving into some place like that and then trying to figure out how to occupy it and to fill it up and all that, but there were people that were moving it to like people on just a basic salary like her character would have had. She was an administrative assistant, or as how was she described in it, like a not a secretary.
She says that's what they call the secretaries now.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what they call the secretaries now.
Such a brilliant Yeah, it's a brilliant moment because it kind of describes the entire language of the film in a nutshell. That interaction, and like for as an example, because I'm changing course here a little bit from the apartment to now to dialogue and to their relationship, but the communication between these two people is so intense. I you have two people that are very, very careful in trying to present in a particular way to each other. And because they're so self-conscious on some level, I guess, about how they're presenting. Like it turns out your character comes clean later on, we won't give too much away, but you're trying to come off in a particular way and she is too. And the verbal intercourse is awkward and comes off completely wrong and clumsy. It's hard to watch.
Yeah. Well, we did the play. I noticed as we did the run, after the run was going for a while, that the audiences would pick one side or the other during the run. So
it could change by tonight?
Yeah. But it became more and more pronounced as we, you know, because I just noticed sometimes I would say something and people would go, and the audience would moan.
Sure.
And sometimes she would do something and they would either love it or hate it. And the play was, what I learned was that the play is not the words or the blocking, or it's the relationship. It's the two of us. And as long as we just keep making it real, or whatever you want to call it in some stupid way, it would take care of itself. And it was just a great thing to learn. You don't have to have everything written down in that.
Yeah.
You know,
but isn't that what the entire excitement of doing live theater is? That it has a life of its own?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we went to do the movie. We sort of, not really in much depth, but we sort of picked, I remember like all the shows, and I would say, remember that show that we did after that hour, that
right.
guy was in the front? Let's take that section and that'll be the guide. So we sort of did a redo of the play, but picked different parts of it depending on how much we liked them.
Oh, yeah. So your characters' names, you play?
Michael.
Michael, and Karen plays?
Yeah, he's Jackie.
Jackie, Michael and Jackie. So and they work together in a law firm. She, as we said, is a secretary or an administrator, and you're a paralegal. And so, and they've worked together, and they've obviously had a kind of a office thing going on, not romantic per se, but some sort of fun, you know, kind of relationship in the office, which they've had to themselves.
Or what are you doing?
What?
I said, you're giving away the whole movie.
Well, it's in the setup, isn't it? Okay. I could, if there's something you want to try to.
No, I
won't give away the ending.
I like things where I have no idea what they're like, and I like people to see things that way.
I see, but you're the filmmaker. I think most people, I don't know, we'll leave it at that. I say they do have a kind of a, that's true, there is a little bit of a nuance, maybe. We can cut a little of this out if you want. But they know each other from their office, and now they're on this date, which, you know, doesn't necessarily translate. In other words, you can have a type of relationship in when you work together, but then if you try to take it outside, it could go anywhere, right? So that's kind of what we're seeing play out.
Yeah.
You know.
I do.
Now I'm afraid I'll say something.
I'll
you off. You what?
I said I'll correct you if you do.
Okay, thank you.
I don't feel pissed off. I just cringe a little bit. Like I can't stand coming attractions. I can't stand movie posters. I don't even like titles.
You do know that you don't represent most people, nor do I probably, but you don't probably represent the majority of people. They kind of want to have some information.
No way do I. through no wish of my own.
So if I can go off a little bit off topic, how do you end up choosing if you don't want any kind of the less information the better, how do you choose what you're gonna look at or watch or buy a ticket for?
I see somebody in a movie that I like, and I watch everything that they're in.
Yeah, I do that too. You're an example for me. Like I might see everything you do because I also had that same.
Oh, thank you.
Who's an example for you? If we could.
I'm trying to think what we've been watching lately. We've been watching Pasolini the last few days.
Fun stuff.
Because I didn't run into him. I saw him on the street in Rome once when I was there.
Get out.
I was just walking and people were like, that's Pier Paolo, you know?
Yeah. They did say that. He's like a big celebrity, or was, I should say.
Yeah, I mean, people were talking. It was like, Jesus. And I somehow recognized them. I can't remember from what. I'm trying to think of who else I have we've tuned in on.
Well, for directors, for sure, one will. Sorry to interrupt you.
No, help me.
Directors, obviously, you kind of, there's like an artistic journey that they're on, right? So it's very interesting to kind of watch as much as you can.
Like Hal Ashby, I mean, you've seen one of them, I want to see them all. And they're all kind of different. I mean, we also watched Godfather 3. I tried again. This is the second time. I vowed I never would try, but I tried again to watch it.
Oh, there's his new edit.
Yeah, it's a little better, but it's not good. It's really painful because the movies are so amazing.
But But film creative types take risks and they sometimes fail, right? So, you know.
Yeah. I mean, he gave so much. I mean, there's so much that is incredible, and I don't care, but I just wish there was more of it.
Did you ever work with him, for instance, Coppola?
No, I met him once. I auditioned, or whatever the word would be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you had a meeting. Getting back to What Happened Was, which again, it will be out. It will be available to watch on January 29th, which is Friday, this Friday, in a new 4K restoration. You mentioned Scott Hall, Scott McCauley was a producer. Was he instrumental in bringing this to Good Machine back then? Who was the original distributor?
What happened is I did a show called Monsters. You remember Monsters? It was the spinoff from Tales from the Dark Side.
Okay.
It was a show that had a monster in it that sort of the story rotated around. And somehow through Bob Balaban, I got a gig writing and directing an episode because they had asked him to do it, and then he couldn't get out of it. So he said, "Well, you know what you're doing." And he says, "Took me in and introduced me." So I did this episode. Where am I going with this?
What connected you with Ted?
Oh, Ted. And I got there the first day, and the producers came out and said, "This is Ted Hope. He's going to be your AD."
Oh.
And he was my AD. So
this Monsters episode?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And we became like friends. Sure. And, you know, I said, you know, he had just started working with Hal Hartley, and it was mostly through that friendship that I wrote this and I started working on it. And I thought, this would be interesting to make a movie of this. You know, that's sort of the idea from the beginning, was to make a movie. And so I had him come to the show. And then he brought all the sort of tech people that he knew that might be interested in doing something like this to see it. So having the people that I paid for the whole thing, because I worked in movies, but having all those crew people come, that's how I found Joe DeSalvo. That's how I found,
I see,
you know, the grips and the doll, everybody. And then you know, it got into Sundance, which I thought was a miracle. And I had
you were well connected too. I mean, you had some good people working and producing that had probably really good and also. I keep interrupting, I apologize, but I don't want to. But it was also the timing of the film was in this peak of the this whole movement of films. So, you know, you were seen to be working with people that were right in the center of that. I mean, from what I can tell, you know, it was at that time in the early to mid 90s, there was a lot of money and there was for independent films and they were becoming huge. You were doing, so you were part of that whole wave, I think, possibly.
It would seem so, yeah. And that seemed cool. I mean, there are a lot of, I worked with a lot of people who did those kind of movies, and you know, it. I learned a lot before I shot.
And you say it went to Sundance, which was a great help for getting it distributed, and then you won the film won the grand jury prize that year.
Yeah. And won the Waldo Salt Writing Award.
And the Writing Award. That had to feel probably best of all for you.
That was great, yeah. Because it's always when you're an actor and you do a movie and you've written it, everybody's like, oh, okay. But it gave a certain legitimacy to me.
So you as an actor too?
Yeah, well, I guess, yeah.
Artist?
Yeah. And also, there was a grant from Panavision. Where they gave a package of a camera package for a shoot to anybody the administration at Sundance picked. And I'm not the most go along with stuff person, so there was a good deal of tension between me and them and at times. But they were very, it was amazing. They gave me this package, which is worth $45,000. I had the best camera in the world, and I, you know, the best set of lenses ever, you know.
So yeah, yeah.
They were very, very helpful to me.
This has to be a peak in your career.
Back then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, maybe in the whole thing. I mean, it's always, I mean, cast in a particular thing is always great, or if you, you know, but I mean, artistically speaking, the whole trajectory of making that film at that time had to be just very gratifying for you as an artist.
So. Yeah. Also the Sundance workshops that they have, one happens in the winter, it's the writing one. And then there's one in June where you shoot what you wrote in January. Then in August, there's you meet producers to see if they could help you get the movie off or get it sold. But in my class, I used to call it school, there was Allison McLean. Do you know Allison?
She yeah.
Jesus' son?
Uh-huh, yep, sure.
Quentin Tarantino.
Never heard of him.
At that point, had really done nothing except sold videos.
Right.
Yep. And I used to just make fun of him all day.
He hasn't cast you in anything, has he?
No.
Bastard.
No, I was sort of mean to him, so.
Okay.
And he somehow holds that against me. I just make fun of him because he's a funny guy. He's a very idiosyncratic person. Can't remember who else. Tim Roth was there.
Wow. Yeah. He got along well with Quentin Tarantino.
I think Quentin brought him.
Oh, okay. I was going to say cast him in.
But there was a lot of, you know, so it was a place where you could meet a lot of people too. And a lot of people were very ambitious and busy. And, you know, within a couple of months after this ended, this workshops ended, a lot of us had films almost done. Here I am.
Yeah.
That's a line from Manhunter.
From which one?
Manhunter.
Manhunter. Yeah. Which you were played, I understand you were in.
You didn't see it?
Francis Dollarhyde? Yes, I seen it.
Okay.
Yeah. Are you kidding me? As a matter of fact, I was thinking one day my sister, who lived in the village at the time, my parents lived in the village. I lived in like on 15th Street and 3rd Avenue. My sister lived right by Astor. And I remember one time she was like saying, oh, I just saw this guy. This is like 30 years ago. This is probably around the time of the What Happened was coming out. And she said, I just saw that actor, you know, the one who was in, who played the guy, you know, the character, the serial killer. And
Manhunter.
Yeah, but I don't know if she said that. But anyway, I was trying to like, well, who is she talking? I realized who she was. Some time later, I realized who she was talking. She was talking about you, and you were probably living pretty. You guys, you know, we all lived around the same neighborhood at the time, so
yeah,
probably made sense that it was you. But that certainly put you on my radar, of course. That role.
Yeah.
You know, what year was that? 80.
85. We shot it. I think 86. It came out. Roughly those dates.
Yeah. Okay. I'm just trying to figure out how long before you directed.
It was 5 years later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it must feel very gratifying just to start. I think we have to, I'm not sure, but maybe we're supposed to wind things down soon, but it just has to feel very gratifying that now it's 2021. So, 26-27 years later, and it's still out there. It's still of interest. It's coming back around again. New people will see this for the first time. Other people will see it again, like myself. And I'm going to probably, you know, I'll go to the film forum site and watch it to support you. And it must feel good.
Yeah, and there's a woman. Whose name escapes me because who writes for Film Comment? About a year ago, she wrote this like treatise about What Happened Was.
Oh.
But it was this monumental accomplishment, you know, and that led to some excitement about the movie and bringing it back. And I think that
really,
I think that had something to do with this getting done.
Interesting. Oh, well, what's we should ask Sydney then about
Scott would know, yeah, or Sydney.
Oh, it's Scott, true. I should bring. Well, how do you feel if I Sheila O'Malley? Thank you, Sydney. Sheila O'Malley is the writer of that, the author of that article that on Film Comment. So we can thank Sheila. We have her here. She's gonna Zoom crash the Zoom bomb, whatever. That would be pretty cool. I was thinking of reaching out to Karen about maybe talking to her about it. Talking about what happened was coming back out. Have you spoken to her about it?
Yes, we talked the other night. She's moving back out here.
What?
She's been in LA for 20 years.
Yeah, she has a beautiful place.
She did, no longer.
Oh. So she's moving to New York?
Yeah, somewhere nearby.
I don't know where you are, but what county again? You can say
that. I'm trying not to tell you.
Okay. I'm not going to come over.
That Dollarhyde guy, he lives in the next county, I heard.
I see. <yeah.
laughs> Let's go look.
That'll happen. It'll happen. Yeah. I would come over, actually, probably. I'm near I'm in the Hudson Valley, and a friend came up, and we drove over to see the house, the the big pink house.
Yeah.
Because I'm pretty close to it. I mean, I'm not far, and I had always thought, this would be cool to go check it out. Just to see if it's there and if it looks the same, you know?
Yeah.
It's not a real private road, and they put up signs along the road, you know, private road, and then there's fencing around the grounds that as you lead up to it, because people, all the time would cut through the woods and go on their property, you know, so they just had to put up fencing along the road.
Makes sense. Live there?
Though? Yeah. I saw a light on. I didn't go up too close because I didn't want to, you know, get shot or...
Right, you're arrested again for spying.
Yeah, but there were lights on in there, you know, so people were definitely were living in there.
Yeah.
January 29th. What happened was .oscilloscope.net, but you know, I'm sure you can Google any of that and find the film and find out how to watch it.
Yeah. Well, thanks for taking the time.
Anytime, of course. Sure.
This is like the third or fourth time we've done this.
Third time, yeah.
Yeah. Hopefully it'll be twice.
Fourth. Yeah, well, we did this too in, like I say, a few years ago in your village place.
Yeah.
And
it was good.
I hope you. Yeah, I'm never sure because you're hard to read sometimes. But it seemed like we enjoyed it. Well, you met with me a second time, so I guess that spoke volume. What'd you say?
I said keep it that way.
Well, let's hope for that we'll be able to do the next one maybe in person again.
Sure.
You know.
Let's hope so.
Get beyond this place, where we are anyway. This was great. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right.
Buona notte.
Great. All right.
So now I just come home.
It's your lonely apartment.
You know what it's like.
Huh?
Oh my God, look at you. You're so beautiful.
Thank you.
So nice to see you again.
It's so great to see you too, Adam. You look wonderful too.
Well, thank you. I mean, I other than the, you know, the pasty sort of kind of puffy COVID pounds, I feel good. I started a new regiment, and you're a yoga student.
And teacher, yeah.
A teacher, excuse me.
Maybe a student. We're all students.
Exactly. Yeah. That's a very Zen way to look at it. So I started at home, you know, finally, because, it was getting ridiculous. And I'm now living upstate north of the city. So I'm also kind of like, I'm just buried in a little bit more than I usually am. So I have to find ways in the apartment to, stay fit and healthy. So
and mentally healthy too.
And then, yeah, those things are combined though, right? You can't have one without the other.
No,
I mean, not really. So
not how, if it's yep.
How's the yeah. dog? Or I remember when I visited you some years ago, not that long ago, but there was a dog. At least here. One. Oh my gosh. What was it? Oh, there. Oh, very sweet. So sweet.
His name is Augie.
Augie the doggy. Yep.
I call them all delicious.
One of my good friends, her dog is named Augie as well.
Really?
It's a good name for and also when I was growing up, my one of my aunts had a dog named Augie.
That's so interesting. I've never really heard that. I mean, I know August Strindberg. But I don't really know.
As his friends called him, Augie Strindberg.
Augie Strindberg. Augie misogynist Strindberg.
They were like, Augie, snap out of it. You're a little down. You're a little intense. Lighten up, Augie.
Treat your women better.
Did he treat his, like, the women in his life?
Awful.
Oh, I didn't know. So it's hard to joke about it now.
Yes, Siri, which is so weird to say that name now, but was one of his first wives. I think he had three. Mm-hmm. And not a good situation at all. Well, you know Miss Julie, the play that I did over and over and over in different places.
It's like one, you know, are you like one of those cases of like lucky, like, you know, how, I don't know, Zero Mostel will forever be known for Tevye or whatever. Like there are certain actors that are just associated with certain roles. So
I think I'm associated with Jackie and What Happened Was.
That's a good one though. You were I saw it again, of course, since you brought it up. Like, just nights ago, I put it on again. And what I told Tom is that every time I've watched it, I've seen it now three times, it just gets, I'm more and more blown away by the performances and just by the level of acting and writing in that. It's just unbelievable. It really is. It's harder to watch too, because you're just like dying from watching these people that, you know, like this difficulty communicating, and they're so desperate, you know, to connect, and they can't, you know, or they have trouble anyway doing that. Did you get to see it again recently, or is it?
I replay it in my mind every day. I mean, we created both these roles on off-Broadway, so.
Right, that's right.
You know, it's very different when you have the ability to actually create something on the stage.
Yes, sure.
And then have it filmed. It's like, it's such a gift. It's so, it's a very, very different experience.
Your character, Jackie, she just, what, you know, you created this. There's a point where I just got to bring it up because I've forgotten about it till I watched it again, where you are reading a short story you write. Your character reads the short. She's an office administrator or secretary, you know. Yeah. And in a law firm, and but you know, have always kind of been what's the right word? Not jealous. Envious is a good word, maybe, or just always, you know, it's clear, like, the people that artists are, you hold to great, you know, that she held to a great esteem, right? I mean, she's really, it's like, it's so she took, tried to write this, or did write this story. And when she starts it off, I guess I shouldn't give away too much, because just the way you start.
Because we're streaming very soon.
That's right. No, as a matter of fact, today is Tuesday. As we're speaking,
it's Friday, right?
Friday, it's going to be out in virtual cinemas, including like Film Forum, and at the Lemley's in LA, where you are.
Very exciting.
Yeah. So on their virtual cinema on their virtual cinemas, which are, you know, online. Sadly, we can't go into cinemas right now, but
I know.
You know,
that's a whole other conversation.
It is. We don't have to go there. Because we've spent the last part of the
we've been there for a year. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. But I just, the character, you were so, whether or not you, the time workshopping it, although it's not, I mean, you weren't just workshopping, you were performing.
Yeah,
it.
Yeah, we were performing.
But you workshopped it, but it was kind of like a built-in workshop for the film version where a lot more people saw it.
Thank God.
Yeah. Oh, what a gift, you know. But it's really, after seeing it multiple times now, I'm like, yeah, what you guys created was really dynamite, and I'm really glad that you guys got to do it on screen, you know. And now it's gonna have a 4K restoration, or it has a 4K restoration.
Yeah, it's pretty remarkable. I'm very excited about this.
Have you gotten to see the restored one, the new one version yet?
I have not yet.
It's restored in your memory. It's
that for sure. Yeah. Well, no.
Yeah. But you and I talked a few years ago. We did on the phone, I think.
Yes, we did.
For similarly, another kind of return to and restored films of Hal Hartley. He was releasing some box sets, and you were in a couple of the films, and so we talked
then. Yeah.
And then I made a trip to LA, and somehow ended up running into you in your home.
How did that happen?
I don't know. Just good fortune.
Maybe an invitation?
I was so thrilled to do that, and I really had a good time. What a beautiful home. So how much can you tell me about, since I learned that you're moving back to the East Coast, is it what? Can you talk about that, or are you comfortable talking a little bit about it, or?
Sure.
I didn't know what was on the,
the checklist of do's and don'ts.
Well, it's private. It could be private. It's personal. So I didn't want to take that for granted, but you are one of a number of people who I know who have made such a move. So my friend Ileana Douglas moved.
Moving back East. The timing is just right. For the family, for me, I've got an older daughter going into college, and I won't disclose her choices because she's still deciding.
Okay, and, I was going to say, because if it's an Ivy League, I don't know. I don't want to make any assumptions about that, but I'm just saying it could be that that's on the north. In the north, most of them are in the Northeast, of course. So,
and then the younger one's going into high school, so that's going to be.
How do they feel about the move?
They're the ones who said, why are we waiting? Let's do this now. We're in Zoom hell at school, and they're thriving though in a weird way, but they're doing great emotionally. It just felt right. You know, it just, the timing is perfect. You know, my husband's a writer and I'm an actor, and we are both from New York. As you know, I'm from Brooklyn. He's from Queens. And the timing just felt so right. I'm not sure how my dog's going to feel about it, but we're going to work on that.
Now, why the location?
I can hear music. Ivan, I hear your music. We're working in a small apartment right now.
Oh, is that true?
Yeah, so we sold our house and
you sold it. You had to sell it when you had the opportunity presented. So yeah. So now you're
all set. And so we're renting in Santa Monica, which you know, so it's nice. It's a different experience.
Sure. What? Yeah, very spacious setup.
Yeah, so we're all transitioning and looking forward to going back east. So the girls are really they're on board because it's all new anyway. And the last year has been so odd
that
it's not like we're doing anything outside of our bubble, you know? So,
well, my son, I don't want to go too much off topic, but he's, with his mom in LA right now. And he's having he wants to be nowhere but Brooklyn where he grew up and where his high school is. So
which high school did he go to?
He goes to this high school, Brooklyn High School of the Arts. So it's,
of course he does. And,
he's on their real-time schedule. So he's getting up at the crack of dawn. No pun, no exaggeration.
Yeah. No, I hear you.
And he was with me for months. And, I moved up to the Hudson Valley. So I'm...
Where are you?
I'm about 100 miles north of the New York City.
Okay.
So that's why when you mentioned it, I was like, well, where in that state?
Right.
We'll keep it as vague as that. But because I wanted to check out, and I think I emailed you back. I have a very good friend. We get on the Zoom or FaceTime almost every night. I used to work for him.
Right.
And we're very good friends. And so he's in the town nearby. So, and he's been urging me to come. So sometime in the spring, I might accidentally run into you again in your home. If you'll have me.
Just let me know before.
I so can't wait to see you in person, Karen, because you're such
I know,
a,
me too.
You're a very special person. And
thank you.
You know, you are. And it comes through in your work. And, it's been a gift to get to know somebody like yourself. I mean, this thing, which started as a lark in a way, just to be able to talk to people who are true artists, it's nice. It's great. It's very inspiring. It's inspired me to be more artistic. This period has reconnected me. I don't know how you're coping, but I've picked up as a matter of fact, drove to Woodstock because I don't mind if people know generally where I am at the moment, because please come and bother me and stalk me because I'm desperate. But I had a guitar repaired because I've gotten so back into my music just for myself.
I've noticed. I follow you. Yeah.
I forgot about that. That's right. I do post some of the songs. So.
Oh, it's
but it's, I, you know, some of them were kind of whatever. It doesn't matter. I just been enjoying watching myself again get better at just playing. I can tell to my own satisfaction. So have you been able to keep yourself going? You have two, obviously you said you're raising a family and you have the dog and you have your yoga and... But what about art?
We're talking about me now.
Yes.
Not my daughters. No, don't worry.
No, yeah, you.
Both my daughters are playing guitar, and
they are.
Older daughter wrote a song. And so it's interesting how I'm looking at the silver linings and not just in my hair of this time. it's been beautiful to watch them discover their own musicality and artistry with the guitar. I do not play the guitar, but I like listening to them and watching them all that.
I said art, not guitar.
No, so. I know.
Okay.
I know.
I wasn't sure.
I see a guitar behind your head, so I'm just looking at that guitar.
Right, that one is the cheapy one that I've been playing on those Instagram, but I picked up my good guitar today. It was repaired finally. I finally just said, I gotta start to, really enjoy this. So I had this guitar that I've been neglecting that I bought when I was in high school. So they repaired that.
Oh, wow. So yeah, just to get back to the question, how am I maintaining my art? I think I'm just the art of living right now, this year, for me, I'm sure for everybody, but, you know, just being really gentle with myself about the timing of a lot of things, my children's years and ages, my husband's career and his work, and, you know, having had a film that T11 Incomplete, which I think I talked to you about. I think I was working on it when we first.
Funny. Yes.
Well, it's been finished, and the momentum was so devastatingly depressing because it came out. The opening was in Sydney and then Melbourne, but every festival got canceled. New York, everything, all over the world,
yeah.
The country, the UK. So this year, I'm not going to complain because we're all healthy and there's a lot of things going on, obviously. But it was really weird, you know, last year to have had a film that meant and means a lot to me and to not share it with people. It was like a anticlimactic, depressing year.
Cool.
So, yeah. But the positive side is that it's being released in the UK in the end of March, and then also in the States in the beginning of April, which I'll get more info on that and share.
Yeah.
Which is very exciting.
Okay, so it will
be available. That's like my art for the year, but it's really good art.
Well,
art of living sane and
absolutely
healthy.
Absolutely. No, right. And you know, and you're moving, it's a lot. That's a lot.
Yeah, it is.
And you moved temporarily into this space. So I'm imagining it's been a lot of
work. It's kind of a relief to be. I feel like we're in a back home in New York City apartment, you know. It's like, shh, quiet, I'm working, or, you know, it's really.
That was such good acting that I thought somebody was standing right off camera and you were talking just now.
I still got it, I guess.
You got
but
it.
But I'm really looking forward to the restored version of what happened was. It's, you know, it's gonna be 30 years. And I'm dating myself next year.
Came out, oh, right, because it came out in 90. Well, you
well, we did
the play it in or 90, the film?
Well, we did the play and the film in 92.
Okay, right. And then it was, it won, because I did it when the 93 or 94 Sundance then?
94 Sundance was 94 Sundance, yeah.
Right.
So that's and quite a long time ago.
Screenwriting, as Tom would remind me, and screenwriter for best screenplay.
Yes.
Or screenwriter award at Sundance as well.
Yes.
Which actually is quite prestigious.
It was wonderful.
That's an incredible, that much time went by. It's just amazing.
Yeah, it's a long time.
That was also, it was also an incredible, remarkable time and to the film's fortune, it came out in a period where there was this huge swell of indie films. Like people were just, you know, rode that wave with all those
hungry for them. Like the Cassavetes was all over filmmakers' minds and brains and pocketbooks too, because it's not easy. You know, it wasn't easy to. Well, Tom will tell you more about that part, but. You know, I mean, when we were here in LA, it was my first time in LA in 94 for the, the Independent Spirit Awards. And we were opposite Pulp Fiction. And I was just like pinching myself going, that was a Miramax, Quentin Tarantino, $10 million production. And here we are. I'm not going to give specifics, but I think it was like $250,000 to make this. And we're in the competition. They won, but it doesn't matter. You know, we propelled and catapulted, I think, my career for sure.
Okay.
I mean, Tom had already been out there
as an actor. More than,
as an actor, but yeah. As a writer director, it was his premiere.
And it seems to meant a lot more to him than anything else.
And I think, you know, I have similar feelings. It's like a baby, you know, when you get to create something on stage and then you have the ability to actually have it shot and made a film and you're still cast in it and you still can work with the writer director who is also your co-star, that's like very rare and exciting as hell. So that still is inspiring to me, you know.
Were you doing a lot of theater around that, or were you just like taking any gigs that just appealed to you or offered, or how much auditioning were you doing, or you know, did you have a first love?
First love
and oh, like not men. I mean, in like just between doing films or theater, like something like.
So I think my really first love, and was indie films. I just felt like a collaborator, a real community. It started at Purchase, and I'm gonna say it again with Hal Hartley and the whole crew.
Right, of course.
It continues. And so, yeah, I think the indie film, I just love the spirit of it. It's hard financially, but I really resonate towards indie films. And not to mention that I was doing a lot of theater too. I was member, still am, of the Actors Studio. So I did a lot of performing, a lot of working out and scene work, you know, after I graduated, and continue to go here on the East Coast. And I look forward to going back to the West. Which coast am I on? on the East Coast and going back to the studio. It's going to be fun.
Yeah. What went into creating that character? Because she's the result of a lot of process, let's put it that way. Very realistic character.
So one of the things that I chose personally was a person in my life. You know, I was trained in the Method School of Acting at Purchase and then went on to assimilate and do other things in order to survive. And, you know, it was a specific person that was very personal to me. So that was my inner dedication. I remember when Tom and I first met, because we had similar agents, the Gersh agency.
Okay.
And they put us together. And I read the script on a Thursday night. It was like this thick. I swear, it was like a novel. It was a 300, I don't know.
What?
Tom's gonna watch this and deny everything. No, but I read it.
Well, I already talked to him, so you get the last word.
Okay. So we were at Café des Artistes, I believe, in Manhattan. And I remember walking up the stairs and we had this beautiful little table and chair and overlooking the street. And I, not knowing him at all, just having read the script, I said, I think you could cut this in half. Yeah, a lot of balls. Well, I'm from Brooklyn. And I just was like, and he just sat there in his way, like by Monday morning, he did huge edits. And that was the original script that we did off-Broadway. And we did not veer away from any of that when we actually went to production.
Well, so, what was in there?
A lot of talking.
Oh yeah, really. There's two people.
Which I find so interesting because when I was looking at the publicity thing for the release in Film Forum, mm-hmm. What is the company?
Press release? What? Oh, Oscilloscope?
Oscilloscope. Yes. Mm-hmm. Oscilloscope. And I saw what they put together, and obviously Tom. And the silence between in that scene, you know, when the laurels pop in and advertising. And it's so interesting that they chose that scene to publicize, just, you know, entice people or remind people who had maybe seen it. It was so silent. And I think what I really appreciated, number one, and still appreciate about Tom, he's a very stubborn man, but rightfully so. So the fact that some somewhat known actor in 91 or 2, 92, gave a suggestion that, you know, you could cut it in half or take out a third or whatever, and then come back 3 days later, was really, I have huge respect and admiration for that kind of artist and collaborator and creator, you know? I mean, he was the director, is the director, actor, producer, editor, like everything-er, you know? So, right. You know?
Mother, we had father.
Great working relationship. Really understood each other. We got each other. So, to back to your question about the character. So I chose an accent. I don't know if you could tell. Oh, you have seen it. Yeah.
Oh, three times. I know that accent okay. Well.
So I was specific. I also, this was very, very clear for me. I wanted to have extra weight on me. I, at that time in my life, was a triathlete. So I had a lot of muscle anyway. So I just kind of ate a lot more, did a little more method. I wanted Jackie to be fleshy.
Voluptuous,
yeah. You know, all of these. I wanted her to be, I just felt physically that's what I wanted, you know? And that was okay with Tom. And my hair color was not okay with Tom, but that's a whole other conversation. And so it was more of a personal thing. I had, you know, I did all my actor's work, as we all do, you know, to connect the dots. And we shot it all at night. So it was night shoots, which is very, very, very different. And I was just talking to Tom the other day, and every time he calls me, I'm always so surprised and happy. I'm like, Tom! but I remember he would say, you know, when it's 5 o'clock in the morning and the sun's about to come up and we have to get the shot before the light comes in, he'd say, you're so good when you're tired. And I was like, but I understood. And I reminded him that the other day, and he said, I never said that. I was like, you said that many times. You're so much, because it was a relaxation. And, you know, I was like starting out or just getting my footing in the business and the world of indies. So it was all these little things. Anyway, yeah.
Yeah, well,
I don't know if I answered your question about Jackie. She's very personal. And another personal note, when we did the play off-Broadway at the Paradise Theater, which is Tom's theater,
yep.
On 4th Street, in the story, I have a lot of, I'm a writer. Nobody knows.
Right. This is goes back to what I said before. She definitely.
Right.
Yeah.
So, right, we don't want to give away too much, but the kind of actor I am and was and still will be, I've been writing in journals since I was 7. So, you know, those composition books, right? The black and white, right? So many of them, I physically brought them. Oh, there it is.
One of these?
Yeah, so I had so many since I was 7. And for my own personal, I brought them to the set in the theater and had it on the trunk, mm-hmm. in the trunk, and wrote the whole story that my character writes in one of my journals. So that, you know, just doing that.
That's right.
Is wow. Personalizing a lot of things that is really nice. And we also, I know we're talking about the film, but the film really was inspired by the play. And the play was in the circle, circling around. So I sometimes, and it was, you know, I don't want to give it away, but I could like touch somebody in the audience, literally. You could see me sweat, smell my breath, whether you liked it or not, or you know what I mean? Like you're so close. And it was very, very intimate. So right. We really held that integrity when we did the film.
And it helped this didn't it? I talked to Tom about that particular part of how the play was in this. And also, do you feel as an actor, because I never asked this of anybody, and I know a lot of people that, you know, have done theater, but I never asked, do you feel more exposed or vulnerable doing theater in the round? It would make sense you might.
You know, in an interesting way, I was very comforted. There was one night where one woman got up in the middle of it and crossed the center of the stage right through me and went out through the fake door of my apartment. And that was really interesting. Wow. I think there was an issue with her. How can you leave when you're in theater in the round? You're a little tiny theater and, you know, the only way to go out is through
the set.
Yeah. I was just like, because it was in the round, so she couldn't go around and around. I remember just sitting there, I forget what part of the play it was, but just going, I tracked her. I was like this. And the entire theater cracked up. Tom never lost his face. He was just like, and we went right back into the scene. It was just, that was very, very interesting. I find it comforting. I like it being personal. I think that's why I love film so much too. I like the camera in my face. Although lately getting older, it's a little bit more like, but I'm loving that as well. You know, receiving my aging and, you know, just gonna go forward and like all amazing actresses do.
Yeah.
As natural as possible.
Right. Well, the camera
shows a lot.
Shows a lot. Yeah, it shows a lot.
But it's also very, very personal, in my opinion. You know, the relationship you have with your camera person and your lighting people, your sound people, makeup, hair, like, I love that. It's real family. It's real community, collaboration. We're all on the same page, you know, for the most part.
You had already worked with Hal a few times, right, by then, so.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we were at Cannes with some Simple Men, right? So that was, I think that's how Hal, which person am I talking about? Tom. I think that Tom saw my work in Simple Men. And I think that's what made him go, oh, maybe she'd be interested. And I was.
He said he saw like everybody in your age and whatever. And then somebody suggested you. And then, yeah, he just knew.
Yeah, he did. And he could have said no at Café des Artistes. He could have said, nope.
Especially when you came in and cleaned the work in half.
Especially when I said, you can get rid of some of these tapes.
So it's lucky because, you know, if you got rid of half the dialogue, it could have, you've been your half of the dialogue, but fortunately.
Well, yeah. And I'm actually a real believer in, you know, less is more. And I've learned that through my wonderful directors that I've worked with for years.
Minimalist, if there ever was one, right?
Yes. So, yeah.
Space. Yeah.
Also, Suzanne Guasi, who was the director, is the director of T11 Incomplete that's coming out, very much like that too. And she was brought up in Hal and Tom. She saw all my work before this film, and those are her, you know, favorite kinds of films. So that's interesting.
Right. Well, I would understand. I never, you've never been far from my mind because I'm not joking, because when I saw those films, I was coming of an age as a young man. Maybe I'm roughly your age, but I was coming of an age discovering cinema on my own, apart from my parents who introduced me to all the great filmmakers, you know, in the past. Like they love Fellini and Bergman and, you know, and then I was a little young for the Coppolas, you know, but definitely that was the popular cinema. But it wasn't until I was in my 20s, and then all of a sudden there was Hal Hartley out there, people like that. And that's where I kind of, that era was my own era as a, you know, an audience member and a film lover. So those films that I discovered are very personal. I have a very personal relationship with Hal and a number of his, you know, counterparts or what have you.
Oh, hearts.
And so, you know, you and there's a group of people and actors and creative people that are, yeah, that's why I was always so, you know, felt very happy and tickled that, you know, our paths crossed and converged.
I know, it's really cool. It really is.
Yeah, and then, you know, and just very also grateful that the film, what happened was Ellipse is going to get new eyes and ear, you know, new people be introduced to it. And I'm very happy that Oscilloscope, you know, invested in the film to do
this. I'm so grateful. I look forward to meeting them one day.
And Scott McCauley.
Yeah, Scott McCauley.
Great guy.
Rock star. Yeah.
He's a good friend. And I actually emailed him. I haven't heard yet, but I invited him also because, you know, I actually, the early days of the pandemic, he had already and I had talked about, I was worked on a project for Filmmaker Magazine. So the first months while we were getting those stimulus checks and everything, but I also was lucky that I had this, you know, gig that had a payday at the end of it,
Filmmaker Magazine. What? Filmmaker Magazine was, Kettle Mateschko, right? He started it, Scott, and I think, I believe Simple Men, Bobby Burke and I were on the first cover of Filmmaker Magazine.
Really?
Yeah, I'll send it to you. It's really cool.
Or you'll show it to me next spring or summer when I accidentally walk by.
We're not moving in until the summer.
Oh, right, you're moving in the summer.
Yeah.
Right, which is, you're moving when I'm a year almost to the day when I moved here. Because I moved here on June 26th or 28th.
Yeah, we'll be like June 1st, something like mid-whatever. June. Yeah.
It's a good time to move. Then you enjoy the entire beautiful summer and fall in your new location.
Yeah, and try to reorganize weather again.
right out there, my window right now is a winter wonderland. I don't know if I can even, maybe what I could do is show it to you here because I can't move the computer right now. But this is what's going on right outside my window.
Oh, wow. Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's today was the snowstorm. I went to pick up that guitar in right near Woodstock, New York. And as I was driving there, the snow was starting. That's right. We're supposed to get us. So I was kind of hoping to get home before, you know, if in case it became more of a.
Were you able to?
Weather system. What?
Were you able to get home before it became?
Oh, yeah.
And then good.
And after this, I'll go out and I'll shovel because I like doing that kind of stuff.
And it's good exercise.
Yeah, and my new commitment to yoga.
Well, I'm really happy about that for you. I mean, I think for all of us.
Well, I got to do something. And it's, you know, it's good as I was thinking of those stories about these older women who are crippled by arthritis and this and that. And then they start yoga. And then they're all of a sudden like a new person. And another thing, I was just telling somebody how I talked to in the last year or so, since this was, you know, a long time since you and I met, but I had Lee Grant, the actor Lee Grant.
Well, Lee Grant was one of my mentors at the Actor's Studio.
So, wow, what a thrill.
Anyway,
but
go ahead.
Amazing. That's wonderful. I didn't put that together, but she, through...
She's remarkable.
And through she must be doing yoga or something, because when I went to her apartment, because this was all arranged by through some connections, and she agreed to do the podcast. I mean, you know, where do you begin? But I start start with like that, you know.
Yeah. Hello.
I have at my right here at my fingertips. But and it's, you should listen to this conversation if you get a minute, because
I will.
We connected so deeply. It was so you know.
She's lovely.
Be in the moment.
What about, have you ever had Ellen Burstyn or Estelle Parsons or like those? These are like,
I would love it. First of all,
these were my role models at the Actor's Studio. Ellen, for sure. I mean, there were others for sure.
Do you know who? Sheila Nevins is?
Sheila Nevins.
She essentially produced all of the documentaries on, I want to say HBO, but I know I'm just screwing up. Anyway, she's a documentary producer, or she's an older woman. She's left. I mean, she is friends with everybody. She knows that. So she did my podcast some time ago also, and she ended up taking me to see Ellen Burstyn off Broadway, and she was pals with Ellen. And so
I probably know her.
Yeah. So she I met Ellen, and I, you know, and we after the play, I think it was one of the Shakespeare comedies. So it might have been one of the Eric Comedy of Errors. I'm trying to remember where she was so good in it. But so I got to meet her not that long ago. And it was in the Village. And but I can't, you know, it's, you got it. The situation has to be right. And
the timing has to be right.
Yeah, I don't just go up.
Yeah.
I have, but I rarely do. It has to be the right person. But and then I met also Estelle was in a documentary where she lives in this apartment complex for actors and artists in the West Side. You know those apartments on west of Times Square? You know,
yeah, like right off Times Square, the tall ones. Yes, yeah. I know that very well. Yep.
So I have an acquaintance friend who's a documentary filmmaker, and she made a documentary about those, the history of those buildings and all the people that have come out of there.
I'd love to see that.
Oh, yeah.
It takes like 20 years to get in there, I heard.
Yeah, I guess so. It must be quite a waiting list. Anyway, and you know, it's one of those things where when you're not working, like now, they lower the rent for you.
That's awesome.
It's the same. And then when you're working again, they raise it back. You know, it's an incredible situation. So artists have a place to live, you know, in New York City. So, but this documentary, so she was, Estelle was in the documentary. So when they premiered it at Doc NYC, which is the New York City Documentary Film Festival, she was on the, you know, like on the panel or whatever in the Q&A. And then afterwards, we're leaving and she was out there. And again, it's sort of awkward when you don't, if I don't have an introduction or something. But, you know what I mean? But she's like 90 years old also. She's
up there.
Yeah. But, you know, good genes, good DNA. Because, you know.
Yeah, great talents, great mind, great heart.
Yes. Joyce Van Patten, do you know her?
Yeah. Yeah.
She's another one. She, who's also, I don't know if she was at this studio. I guess maybe she was at a different.
There's another Van Patten.
Well, she's probably related to him or her.
Right.
Joyce Van Patten's daughter was married to Martin Balsam. She was married to a lot of men, actually.
But yeah.
He had a daughter. Her daughter is Talia Balsam, who's a fine actor. And And I got to meet her for the podcast, and then just realized, oh, right, your parents are icons of the theater world.
Exactly.
Martin Balsam and
Joyce McPatton. You put it all together.
Yeah. Joyce McPatton. But these people are still working. I mean, Grant, I don't think she acts anymore, but.
No, she was wonderful. She was our moderator a lot, along with Paul Newman and Harvey Keitel, Shelley, Winter.
I don't know any of those. Oh, okay. I never heard of any of them, but they sound great. It's an old joke.
I know. I was blessed to have, gotten into that, which is great. Wonderful.
Well, I appreciate your agreeing to do this, and I hope I haven't inconvenienced your family or whomever's there.
Oh no, my dog's sleeping.
I don't hear him snoring, but
he usually does.
Augie,
you're such a good boy.
I really would love a dog right about now. This I took this place very last minute, and it's very small.
Yeah.
So I'm looking for, I have a potential place that's bigger. Oh, thank you. Augie, thank you for doing my podcast and my YouTube.
Say hi to Adam.
So sweet. How old is he?
He's going to be 7 this August.
So he's definitely, I definitely pet Augie. Because what was I there about? Four years?
I think it was three years ago.
That sounds about right.
Four?
Yeah, somewhere in there.
So he was a little bit of a
wasn't that long baby. Ago. Yeah. It was around that. Yeah, because I and I've been back only probably once since, I think. I was in but I was stuck up at what is the name of the town? It's right across the mountains from Malibu.
Topanga?
No.
Oh, Agora Hills.
No, but it's where like the...
Ventura.
No, it's like where the Kardashians live and all that. I
don't know where they live.
You don't hang out with the Kardashians?
No.
Oh my goodness. Well, they're missing out. I cannot.
Oh, well, it's been so great talking to you, Adam.
Same here. Thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, stay in touch.
Yes. And I'm really looking forward to this new... What happened was.
I know. And the sequel.
Well, that's.
I only mentioned because Tom brought it up.
You can mention it then. I'm very careful with my directors.
I'm bringing it up.
I'm
planting the seeds out there. The demand will be what happened.
Next. I don't know.
I think something like that. Yeah. I think it's a great idea.
We'll
get a little bit of a gauge by the success of this new
We'll see if there's interest. And I know a lot of people that have never seen What Happened Was that even just from my posting are just blown away and so excited. So hopefully the streaming will be very successful.
Do it, buy the tickets, because go to the virtual cinema, your favorite one, and buy the ticket, because as of this Friday, it's Tuesday, today's Tuesday the 26th, so the 29th, it's going to be out there at your, friendly virtual art cinema, and so you get to support Karen, you get to support Tom and the film, but you also support an independent, an art house, which everybody's needing support right now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Adam. Right. Blessings and happy, healthy everything.
Thank you.
Okay.
Take care.
Bye.